Phase the Fifth. The Woman Pays. Part 4. Chapter 43. There was no exaggeration in Marian's definition of Flintcomb Ash Farm as a starve-acre place. The single fat thing on the soil was Marian herself, and she was an importation. Of the three classes of village, the village cared for by its lord, the village cared for by itself, and the village uncared for either by itself or by its lord, in other words, the village of a resident squire's tenantry, the village of free or copyholders, and the absentee owner's village farmed with the land, this place, Flintcomb Ash, was the third. But Tess set to work. Patience, that blending of moral courage with physical timidity, was now no longer a minor feature in Mrs. Angel Clare, and it sustained her. The swede field in which she and her companion were set hacking was a stretch of 100-odd acres in one patch on the highest ground of the farm, rising above stony lanchets or lynchets, the outcrop of siliceous veins in the chalk formation, composed of myriads of loose white flints in bulbous, cusped, and phallic shapes. The upper half of each turnip had been eaten off by the livestock, and it was the business of the two women to grub up the lower or earthy half of the roots with a hooked fork, called a hacker, that it might be eaten also. Every leaf of the vegetable having already been consumed, the whole field was in color a desolate drab. It was a complexion without features, as if a face, from chin to brow, should be only an expanse of skin. The sky wore, in another color, the same likeness, a white vacuity of countenance with the lineaments gone. So these two upper and nether visages confronted each other all day long, the white face looking down on the brown face, and the brown face looking up at the white face, without anything standing between them but the two girls crawling over the surface of the former like flies. Nobody came near them, and their movements showed a mechanical regularity, their forms standing enshrouded in hessian wrappers, sleeved brown pinafores tied behind to the bottom to keep their gowns from blowing about, scant skirts revealing boots that reached high up the ankles, and yellow sheepskin gloves with gauntlets. The pensive character which the curtained hood lent to their bent heads would have reminded the observer of some early Italian conception of the two Marys. They worked on hour after hour, unconscious of the forlorn aspect they bore in the landscape, not thinking of the justice or injustice of their lot. Even in such a position as theirs, it was possible to exist in a dream. In the afternoon the rain came on again, and Marian said that they need not work any more. But if they did not work, they would not be paid. So they worked on. It was so high a situation, this field, that the rain had no occasion to fall, but raced along horizontally upon the yelling wind, sticking into them like glass splinters till they were wet through. Tess had not known till now what was really meant by that. There are degrees of dampness, and a very little is being called wet through in common talk. But to stand working slowly in a field and to feel the creep of rainwater, first in legs and shoulders, then on hips and head, then at back, front, and sides, and yet to work on till the leaden light diminishes and marks that the sun is down, demands a distinct modicum of stoicism, even of valor. Yet they did not feel the wetness so much as might be supposed. They were both young, and they were talking of the time when they lived and loved together at Tabitha's dairy, that happy green tract of land where summer had been liberal in her gifts, in substance to all, emotionally to these. Tess would fain not have conversed with Marian of the man who was legally, if not actually, her husband, but the irresistible fascination of the subject betrayed her into reciprocating Marian's remarks, and thus, as has been said, though the damp curtains of their bonnets flapped smartly into their faces, and their wrappers clung about them to wearisomeness, they lived all this afternoon in memories of green, sunny, romantic Talbothays. "You can see a gleam of a hill within a few miles of Froom Valley from here when 'tis fine," said Marian. "Ah, can you?" So the two forces were at work here as everywhere, the inherent will to enjoy, and the circumstantial will against enjoyment. Marian's will had a method of assisting itself by taking from her pocket, as the afternoon wore on, a pint bottle, corked with white rag, from which she invited Tess to drink. Tess's unassisted power of dreaming, however, being enough for her sublimation at present, she declined, except the merest sip, and then Marian took a pull from the spirits. "I've got used to it," she said, "and can't leave it off now. 'Tis my only comfort. You see, I lost him. You didn't, and you can do without it, perhaps." Tess thought her loss as great as Marian's, but upheld by the dignity of being Angel's wife, in the letter at least, she accepted Marian's differentiation. Amid this scene, Tess slaved in the morning frosts and in the afternoon rains. When it was not swede grubbing, it was swede trimming, in which process she sliced off the earth and the fibers with a billhook before storing the roots for future use. At this occupation they could shelter themselves by a thatched hurdle if it rained, but if it was frosty, even their thick leather gloves could not prevent the frozen masses they handled from biting their fingers. Still, Tess hoped. She had a conviction that sooner or later the magnanimity which she persisted in reckoning as a chief ingredient of Claire's character would lead him to rejoin her. Marian, primed to a humorous mood, would discover the queer-shaped flints aforesaid, and shriek with laughter, Tess remaining severely obtuse. They often looked across the country to where the Var or Froom was now to stretch, even though they might not be able to see it, and, fixing their eyes on the cloaking gray mist, imagined the old times they had spent there. "Ah," said Marian, "how I should like another or two of our old set to come here. Then we could bring up Taubethay's every day here afield, and talk of he, and of what nice times we had there, and of the old things we used to know, and make it all come back, almost, in seeming." Marian's eyes softened, and her voice grew vague as the visions returned. "I'll write to Is Hewitt," she said. "She's biding at home, doing nothing now, I know, and I'll tell her we be here, and ask her to come. And perhaps Reddy is well enough now." Tess had nothing to say against the proposal, and the next she heard of this plan for importing old Tabitha's joys was 2 or 3 days later, when Marian informed her that Is had replied to her inquiry, and had promised to come if she could. There had not been such a winter for years. It came on in stealthy and measured glides, like the moves of a chess player. One morning the few lonely trees and the thorns of the hedgerows appeared as if they had put off a vegetable for an animal integument. Every twig was covered with a white nap, as of fur grown from the rind during the night, giving it 4 times its usual stoutness, the whole bush or tree forming a staring sketch in white lines on the mournful gray of the sky and horizon. Cobwebs revealed their presence on sheds and walls where none had ever been observed till brought out into visibility by the crystallizing atmosphere, hanging like loops of white worsted from salient points of the outhouses, posts, and gates. After this season of congealed dampness came a spell of dry frost, when strange birds from behind the North Pole began to arrive silently on the upland of Flintcomb-Ash, gaunt spectral creatures with tragical eyes, eyes which had witnessed scenes of cataclysmal horror in inaccessible polar regions of a magnitude such as no human being had ever conceived, in curdling temperatures that no man could endure, which had beheld the crash of icebergs and the slide of snow hills by the shooting light of the aurora, been half-blinded by the whirl of colossal storms and terraqueous distortions, and retained the expression of feature that such scenes had engendered. These nameless birds came quite near to Tess and Marian, but of all they had seen, which humanity would never see, they brought no account. The travellers' ambition to tell was not theirs, and with dumb impassivity they dismissed experiences which they did not value for the immediate incidents of this homely upland, the trivial moments of the 2 girls in disturbing the clods with their hackers, so as to uncover something or other that these visitants relished as food. Then, one day, a peculiar quality invaded the air of this open country. There came a moisture which was not of rain, and a cold which was not of frost. It chilled the eyeballs of the twain, made their brows ache, penetrated to their skeletons, affecting the surface of the body less than its core. They knew that it meant snow, and in the night the snow came. Tess, who continued to live at the cottage with the warm gable that cheered any lonely pedestrian who paused beside it, awoke in the night and heard above the thatch noises which seemed to signify that the roof had turned itself into a gymnasium of all the winds. When she lit her lamp to get up in the morning, she found that the snow had blown through a chink in the casement, forming a white cone of the finest powder against the inside, and had also come down the chimney, so that it lay sole-deep upon the floor, on which her shoes left tracks when she moved about. Without, the storm drove so fast as to create a snow mist in the kitchen, but as of yet it was too dark out of doors to see anything. Tess knew that it was impossible to go on with the Swedes, and by the time she had finished breakfast beside the solitary little lamp, Marian arrived to tell her that they were to join the rest of the women at reed-drawing in the barn till the weather changed. As soon, therefore, as the uniform cloak of darkness without began to turn to a disordered medley of grays, they blew out the lamp, wrapped themselves up in their thickest pinners, tied their woolen cravats round their necks and across their chests, and started for the barn. The snow had followed the birds from their polar basin as a white pillar of a cloud, and individual flakes could not be seen. The blast smelt of icebergs, Arctic seas, whales, and white bears, carrying the snow so that it licked the land but did not open on it. They trudged onwards with slanted bodies through the flossy fields, keeping as well as they could in the shelter of hedges, which, however, acted as strainers rather than screens. The air, afflicted to pallor with the hoary multitudes that infested it, twisted and spun them eccentrically, suggesting an achromatic chaos of things. But both the young women were fairly cheerful. Such weather on a dry upland is not in itself dispiriting. "Ha, ha! The cunning northern birds knew this was coming," said Marian. "Depend upon it, they keep just in front of it all the way from the North Star. Your husband, my dear, is, I make no doubt, having scorching weather all this time. Lord, if he could only see his pretty wife now! Not that this weather hurts your beauty at all. In fact, it rather does it good." "You mustn't talk about him to me, Marian," said Tess severely. "Well, but surely you care for him, do you?" Instead of answering, Tess, with tears in her eyes, impulsively faced in the direction in which she imagined South America to lie, and putting up her lips, blew out a passionate kiss upon the snowy wind. "Well, well, I know you do. But upon my body, it is a rum life for a married couple. There, I won't say another word. Well, as for the weather, it won't hurt us in the wheat barn, but reed-drawing is fearful hard work, worse than swede-hacking. I can't stand it, because I'm stout, but you be slimmer than I. I can't think why master should have set ye to it." They reached the wheat barn and entered it. On one end of the long structure was full of corn. The middle was where the reed-drawing was carried on, and there had already been placed in the reed-press the evening before as many sheaves of wheat as would be sufficient for the women to draw from during the day.
"Why, here's Is," said Marian.
Is it was, and she came forward. She had walked all the way from her mother's home on the previous afternoon, and, not deeming the distance so great, had been belated, arriving, however, just before the snow began, and sleeping at the alehouse. The farmer had agreed with her mother at market to take her on if she came today, and she had been afraid to disappoint him by delay. In addition to Tess, Marian, and Is, there were two women from a neighboring village, two Amazonian sisters, whom Tess, with a start, remembered as Dark Carr, the Queen of Spades, and her junior, the Queen of Diamonds, those who had tried to fight with her in the midnight quarrel at Trantridge. They showed no recognition of her, and possibly had none, for they had been under the influence of liquor on that occasion, and were only temporary sojourners there, as here. They did all kinds of men's work by preference, including well-sinking, hedging, ditching, and excavating,
without any sense of fatigue. Noted reed-drawers were they, too, and looked round upon the other three with some superciliousness. Putting on their gloves, all set to work in a row in front of the press, an erection formed by two posts connected by a cross-beam, under which the sheaves to be drawn from were laid ears outward, the beam being pegged down by pins in the uprights and lowered as the sheaves diminished. The day hardened in color, the light coming in at the barn doors upwards from the snow instead of downwards from the sky. The girls pulled handful after handful from the press, but by reason of the presence of the strange women, who were recounting scandals, Marian and Iz could not at first talk of old times as they wished to do. Presently they heard the muffled tread of a horse, and the farmer rode up to the barn door. When he had dismounted, he came close to Tess and remained looking musingly at the side of her face. She had not turned at first, but his fixed attitude led her to look round, when she perceived that her employer was the native of Trantridge from whom she had taken flight on the high road because of his allusion to her history. He waited till she had carried the drawn bundles to the pile outside, when he said, "So you be the young woman who took my civility in such ill part. Be drowned if I didn't think you might be, as soon as I heard of your being hired. Well, you thought you had got the better of me the first time at the inn with your fancy man, and the second time on the road when you bolted. But now I think I've got the better of you," he concluded with a hard laugh. Tess, between the Amazons and the farmer, like a bird caught in a clap-net, returned no answer, continuing to pull the straw. She could read character sufficiently well to know by this time that she had nothing to fear from her employer's gallantry. It was rather the tyranny induced by his mortification at Claire's treatment of him. Upon the whole, she preferred that sentiment in man, and felt brave enough to endure it. "You thought I was in love with ye, I suppose. Some women are such fools to take every look as serious earnest. But there's nothing like a winter afield for taking that nonsense out of young wenches' heads, and you've sighed and agreed to Lady Day. Now, are you going to beg my pardon? I thought you ought to beg mine. Very well, as you like. But we'll see which is master here. Be they all the sheaves you've done today?" "Yes, sir." "'Tis a very poor show. Just see what they've done over there," pointing to the two stalwart women. "The rest, too, have done better than you. They've all practiced it before, and I have not. And I thought it made no difference to you, as it is task work, and we are only paid for what we do." "Oh, but it does. I want the barn cleared. I am going to work all the afternoon, instead of leaving at 2, as the others will do." He looked sullenly at her and went away. Tess felt that she could not have come to a much worse place, but anything was better than gallantry. When 2 o'clock arrived, the professional reed-drawers tossed off the last half-pint in their flagon, put down their hooks, tied their last sheaves, and went away. Marian and Iz would have done likewise, but on hearing that Tess meant to stay, to make up by longer hours for her lack of skill, they would not leave her. Looking out at the snow, which still fell, Marian exclaimed, "Now we've got it all to ourselves." And so, at last, the conversation turned to their old experiences at the dairy, and, of course, the incidents of their affection for Angel Clare. "Iz and Marian," said Mrs. Angel Clare, with a dignity which was extremely touching, seeing how very little of a wife she was, "I can't join in talk with you now, as I used to, about Mr. Clare. You will see that I cannot, because, although he is gone away from me at present, he is my husband." Iz was by nature the sauciest and most caustic of all the four girls who had loved Clare. "He was a very splendid lover, no doubt," she said, "but I don't think he is too fond a husband to go away from you so soon." "He had to go. He was obliged to go, to see about the land over there," pleaded Tess. "He might have tided ye over the winter." "Ah, that's owing to an accident, a misunderstanding, and we won't argue it," Tess answered, with tearfulness in her words. "Perhaps There's a good deal to be said for him. He did not go away, like some husbands, without telling me, and I can always find out where he is."
After this they continued for some long time in a reverie, as they went on seizing the ears of corn, drawing out the straw, gathering it under their arms, and cutting off the ears with their bill-hooks, nothing sounding in the barn but the swish of the straw and the crunch of the hook. Then Tess suddenly flagged, and sank down upon the heap of wheat-ears at her feet.
"I knew you wouldn't be able to stand it," cried Marian. "It wants harder flesh than yours for this work."
Just then the farmer entered.
"Oh, that's how you get on when I'm away," he said to her.
"But it is my own loss," she pleaded, "not yours."
"I want it finished," he said doggedly,
as he crossed the barn and went out at the other door.
"Don't ye mind him, there's a dear," said Marian. "I've worked here before. Now you go and lie down there, and Iz and I will make up your number." "I don't like to let you do that. I'm taller than you, too."
However, she was so overcome that she consented to lie down a while, and reclined on a heap of pull-tails, the refuse, after the straight straw had been drawn, thrown up at the further side of the barn. Her succumbing had been as largely owing to agitation at the reopening of the subject of her separation from her husband as to the hard work. She lay in a state of percipience without volition, and the rustle of the straw and the cutting of the ears by the others had the weight of bodily touches. She could hear from her corner, in addition to these noises, the murmur of their voices. She felt certain that they were continuing the subject already broached, but their voices were so low that she could not catch the words. At last Tess grew more and more anxious to know what they were saying, and persuading herself that she felt better, she got up and resumed work. Then Iz Hewitt broke down. She had walked more than a dozen miles the previous evening, had gone to bed at midnight, and had risen again at 5 o'clock. Marian alone, thanks to her bottle of liquor and her stoutness of build, stood the strain upon back and arms without suffering. Tess urged Iz to leave off, agreeing, as she felt better, to finish the day without her, and make equal division of the number of sheaves. Iz accepted the offer gratefully, and disappeared through the great door into the snowy track to her lodging. Marian, as was the case every afternoon at this time on account of the bottle, began to feel in a romantic vein.
"I should not have thought it of him, never," she said in a dreamy tone, "and I loved him so. I didn't mind his having you, but this about Iz is too bad."
Tess, in her start at the words, narrowly missed cutting off a finger with the bill-hook.
"Is it about my husband?" she stammered. "Well, yes. Iz said, 'Don't you tell her,' but I am sure I can't help it. It was what he wanted Iz to do. He wanted her to go off to Brazil with him."
Tessa's face faded as white as the scene without, and its curves straightened.
"And did Iz refuse to go?" she asked. "I don't know. Anyhow, he changed his mind." "Pooh! Then he didn't mean it. 'Twas just a man's jest." "Yes, he did, for he drove her a good ways towards the station." "He didn't take her."
They pulled on in silence till Tess, without any premonitory symptoms, burst out crying.
"There," said Marian. "Now I wish I hadn't told ye." "No, it is a very good thing that you have done. I have been living on in a third-over lackaday way, and have not seen what it might lead to. I ought to have sent him a letter oftener. He said I could not go to him, but he didn't say I was not to write as often as I liked. I won't dally like this any longer. I have been very wrong and neglectful in leaving everything to be done by him."
The dim light in the barn grew dimmer, and they could see to work no longer. When Tess had reached home that evening and entered into the privacy of her little whitewashed chamber, she began impetuously writing a letter to Claire. But, falling into doubt, she could not finish it. Afterwards she took the ring from the ribbon on which she wore it next to her heart, and retained it on her finger all night,
as if to fortify herself in the sensation that she was really the wife of this elusive lover of hers, who could propose that Iz should go with him abroad so shortly after he had left her. Knowing that, how could she write entreaties to him, or show that she cared for him any more?
Chapter 44. By the disclosure in the barn, her thoughts were led anew in the direction which they had taken more than once of late, to the distant Emminster vicarage. It was through her husband's parents that she had been charged to send a letter to Clare if she desired, and to write to them direct if in difficulty. But that sense of her having morally no claim upon him had always led Tess to suspend her impulse to send those notes, and to the family at the vicarage, therefore, as to her own parents since her marriage, she was virtually non-existent. This self-effacement in both directions had been quite in consonance with her independent character of desiring nothing by way of favor or pity, to which she was not entitled on a fair consideration of her deserts. She had set herself to stand or fall by her qualities, and to waive such merely technical claims upon a strange family as had been established for her by the flimsy fact of a member of that family, in a season of impulse, writing his name in a church book beside hers. But now that she was stung to a fever by Iz's tale, there was a limit to her powers of renunciation. Why had her husband not written to her? He had distinctly implied that he would at least let her know of the locality to which he had journeyed, but he had not sent a line to notify his address. Was he really indifferent? But was he ill? Was it for her to make some advance? Surely she might summon the courage of solicitude, call at the vicarage for intelligence, and express her grief at his silence. If Angel's father were the good man she had heard him represented to be, he would be able to enter into her heart-starved situation. Her social hardships she would conceal. To leave the farm on a weekday was not in her power. Sunday was the only possible opportunity. Flintcomb Ash being in the middle of the Cretaceous tableland over which no railway had claimed as yet, it would be necessary to walk. And the distance being 15 miles each way, she would have to allow herself a long day for the undertaking by rising early. A fortnight later, when the snow had gone and had been followed by a hard black frost, she took advantage of the state of the roads to try the experiment. At 4 o'clock that Sunday morning she came downstairs and stepped out into the starlight. The weather was still favorable, the ground ringing under her feet like an anvil. Marian and Iz were much interested in her excursion, knowing that the journey concerned her husband. Their lodgings were in a cottage a little further along the lane, but they came and assisted Tess in her departure, and argued that she should dress up in her very prettiest guise to captivate the hearts of her parents-in-law, though she, knowing of the austere and Calvinistic tenets of old Mr. Clare, was indifferent and even doubtful. A year had now elapsed since her sad marriage, but she had preserved sufficient draperies from the wreck of her then full wardrobe to clothe her very charmingly as a simple country girl with no pretensions to recent fashion. A soft gray woolen gown, with white crepe quilling against the pink skin of her face and neck, and a black velvet jacket and hat. "'Tis a thousand pities your husband can't see ye now. You do look a real beauty," said Iz Hewitt, regarding Tess as she stood on the threshold between the steely starlight without and the yellow candlelight within. Iz spoke with a magnanimous abandonment of herself to the situation. She could not be, no woman with a heart bigger than a hazelnut could be, antagonistic to Tess in her presence, the influence which she exercised over those of her own sex being of a warmth and strength quite unusual, curiously overpowering the less worthy feminine feelings of spite and rivalry. With a final tug and touch here and a slight brush there, they let her go, and she was absorbed into the pearly air of the foredawn. They heard her footsteps tap along the hard road as she stepped out to her full pace. Even Iz hoped she would win, and, though without any particular respect for her own virtue, felt glad that she had been prevented wronging her friend when momentarily tempted by Clare. It was a year ago, all but a day, that Clare had married Tess, and only a few days less than a year, that he had been absent from her.
Still, to start on a brisk walk and on such an errand as hers on a dry, clear, wintry morning, through the rarefied air of these chalky hogs' backs, was not depressing. And there is no doubt that her dream at starting was to win the heart of her mother-in-law, tell her whole history to that lady, enlist her on her side, and so gain back the truant. In time she reached the edge of a vast escarpment below which stretched the loamy vale of Blackmoor, now lying misty and still in the dawn. Instead of the colourless air of the uplands, the atmosphere down there was a deep blue. Instead of the great enclosures of 100 acres in which she was now accustomed to toil, there were little fields below her of less than 6 acres, so numerous that they looked from this height like the meshes of a net. Here the landscape was whitey brown. Down there, as in Froom Valley, it was always green. Yet it was in that vale that her sorrow had taken shape, and she did not love it as formerly. Beauty to her, as to all who have felt, lay not in the thing, but in what the thing symbolized. Keeping the vale on her right, she steered steadily westward. Passing above the Hintocks, crossing at right angles the high road from Sherton Abbas to Casterbridge, and skirting Dogberry Hill and Highstoy, with the dell between them called the Devil's Kitchen. Still following the elevated way, she reached Cross in Hand, where the stone pillar stands desolate and silent, to mark the site of a miracle, or murder, or both. 3 miles further she cut across the straight and deserted Roman road called Long Ash Lane, leaving which, as soon as she reached it, she dipped down a hill by a transverse lane into a small town or village of Evershead, being now about halfway over the distance. She made a halt here, and breakfasted a second time, heartily enough, not at the Sow and Acorn, for she avoided inns, but at a cottage by the church. The second half of her journey was through a more gentle country, by way of Benville Lane. But as the mileage lessened between her and the spot of her pilgrimage, so did Tess's confidence decrease, and her enterprise loom out more formidably. She saw her purpose in such staring lines, and the landscape so faintly, that she was sometimes in danger of losing her way. However, about noon she paused by a gate on the edge of the basin in which Emminster and its vicarage lay. The square tower, beneath which she knew that at that moment the vicar and his congregation were gathered, had a severe look in her eyes. She wished that she had somehow contrived to come on a weekday. Such a good man might be prejudiced against a woman who had chosen Sunday, never realizing the necessities of her case. But it was incumbent upon her to go on now. She took off the thick boots in which she had walked thus far, put on her pretty thin ones of patent leather, and stuffing the former into the hedge by the gatepost, where she might readily find them again, descended the hill. The freshness of the colour she had derived from the keen air thinning away in spite of her as she drew near the parsonage. Tess hoped for some accident that might favour her, but nothing favoured her. The shrubs on the vicarage lawn rustled uncomfortably in the frosty breeze. She could not feel by any stretch of imagination, dressed to her highest as she was, that the house was the residence of near relations. And yet nothing essential, in nature or emotion, divided her from them. In pains, pleasures, thoughts, birth, death, and after-death, they were the same. She nerved herself by an effort, entered the swing gate, and rang the doorbell. The thing was done. There could be no retreat. No, the thing was not done. Nobody answered to her ringing. The effort had to be risen to and made again. She rang a second time, and the agitation of the act, coupled with her weariness after 15 miles' walk, led her to support herself while she waited by resting her hand on her hip and her elbow against the wall of the porch. The wind was so nipping that the ivy leaves had become wizened and gray, each tapping incessantly upon its neighbor with a disquieting stir of her nerves. A piece of blood-stained paper, caught up from some meat buyer's dust heap, beat up and down the road without the gate, too flimsy to rest, too heavy to fly away, and a few straws kept it company. The second peal had been louder, and still nobody came. Then she walked out of the porch, opened the gate, and passed through. and though she looked dubiously at the house front as if inclined to return, it was with a breath of relief that she closed the gate. A feeling haunted her that she might have been recognized, though how she could not tell, and orders been given not to admit her. Tess went as far as the corner. She had done all she could do, but determined not to escape present trepidation at the expense of future distress, she walked back again, quite past the house, looking up at all the windows. Ah, the explanation was that they were all at church, every one. She remembered her husband saying that his father always insisted upon the household, servants included, going to morning service, and, as a consequence, eating cold food when they came home. It was, therefore, only necessary to wait till the service was over. She would not make herself conspicuous by waiting on the spot, and she started to get past the church into the lane. But as she reached the churchyard gate, the people began pouring out, and Tess found herself in the midst of them. The Emminster congregation looked at her as only a congregation of small country townsfolk walking home at its leisure can look at a woman out of the common who it perceives to be a stranger. She quickened her pace and ascended the road by which she had come to find a retreat between its hedges till the vicar's family should have launched, and it might be convenient for them to receive her. She soon distanced the churchgoers, except two youngish men, who, linked arm in arm, were beating up behind her at a quick step. As they drew nearer, she could hear their voices engaged in earnest discourse, and with the natural quickness of a woman in her situation, did not fail to recognize in those noises the quality of her husband's tones. The pedestrians were his two brothers. Forgetting all her plans, Tess's one dread was lest they should overtake her now, in her disorganized condition, before she was prepared to confront them. For though she felt that they could not identify her, she instinctively dreaded their scrutiny. The more briskly they walked, the more briskly walked she. They were plainly bent upon taking a short, quick stroll before going indoors to lunch or dinner, to restore warmth to limbs chilled with sitting through a long service. Only one person had preceded Tess up the hill, a ladylike young woman, somewhat interesting, though perhaps a trifle guindé and prudish. Tess had nearly overtaken her when the speed of her brothers-in-law brought them so nearly behind her back that she could hear every word of their conversation. They said nothing, however, which particularly interested her, till, observing the young lady still in front, one of them remarked, "There is Mercy Chant. Let us overtake her." Tess knew the name. It was the woman who had been destined for Angel's life companion by his and her parents, and whom he probably would have married but for her intrusive self. She would have known as much without previous information if she had waited a moment, for one of the brothers proceeded to say, "Ah, poor Angel! I never see that nice girl without more and more regretting his precipitancy in throwing himself away upon a dairymaid, or whatever she may be. It is a queer business, apparently. Whether she has joined him yet or not, I don't know, but she had not done so some months ago when I heard from him. I can't say. He never tells me anything nowadays. His ill-considered marriage seems to have completed that estrangement from me which was begun by his extraordinary opinions." Tess beat up the long hill still faster, but she could not outwalk them without exciting notice. At last they outsped her altogether and passed her by. The young lady, still further ahead, heard their footsteps and turned. Then there was a greeting and a shaking of hands, and the three went on together. They soon reached the summit of the hill, and evidently intending this point to be the limit of their promenade, slackened pace and turned all three aside to the gate whereat Tess had paused an hour before that time to reconnoiter the town before descending into it. During their discourse, one of the clerical brothers probed the hedge carefully with his umbrella and dragged something to light. "Here's a pair of old boots," he said, "thrown away, I suppose, by some tramp or other. Some impostor who wished to come into the town barefoot, perhaps, and so excite our sympathies," said Miss Chant. "Yes, it must have been, for they are excellent walking boots, by no means worn out. What a wicked thing to do! I'll carry them home for some poor person." Cuthbert Clare, who had been the one to find them, picked them up for her with the crook of his stick, and Tess's boots were appropriated. She, who had heard this, walked past under the screen of her woolen veil, till, presently looking back, she perceived that the church party had left the gate with her boots and retreated down the hill. Thereupon our heroine resumed her walk. Tears, blinding tears, were running down her face. She knew that it was sentiment, all baseless impressibility, which had caused her to read the scene as her own condemnation. Nevertheless, she could not get over it. She could not contravene in her own defenseless person all those untoward omens. It was impossible to think of returning to the vicarage. Angel's wife felt almost as if she had been hounded up that hill like a scorned thing by those, to her, superfine clerics. Innocently as the slight had been inflicted, it was somewhat unfortunate that she had encountered the sons and not the father, who, despite his narrowness, was far less starched and ironed than they, and had to the full the gift of charity. As she again thought of her dusty boots, she almost pitied those habiliments for the quizzing to which they had been subjected, and felt how hopeless life was for their owner. "Ah," she said, still sighing in pity of herself, "they didn't know that I wore those over the roughest part of the road to save those pretty ones he bought for me. No, they did not know it, and they didn't think that he chose the color of my pretty frock. No, how could they? If they had known, perhaps they would not have cared, for they don't care much for him, poor thing." Then she grieved for the beloved man whose conventional standard of judgment had caused her all these latter sorrows, and she went her way without knowing that the greatest misfortune of her life was this feminine loss of courage at the last and critical moment through her estimating her father-in-law by his sons. Her present condition was precisely one which would have enlisted the sympathies of old Mr. and Mrs. Clare. Their hearts went out of them at a bound towards extreme cases, when the subtle mental troubles of the less desperate among mankind failed to win their interest or regard. In jumping at publicans and sinners, they would forget that a word might be said for the worries of scribes and Pharisees, and this defect or limitation might have recommended their own daughter-in-law to them at this moment as a fairly choice sort of lost person for their love. Thereupon she began to plod back along the road by which she had come, not altogether full of hope, but full of a conviction that a crisis in her life was approaching. No crisis apparently had supervened, and there was nothing left for her to do but to continue upon that Starve-Acre farm till she could again summon courage to face the vicarage. She did, indeed, take sufficient interest in herself to throw up her veil on this return journey, as if to let the world see that she could at least exhibit a face such as Mercy Chant could not show. But it was done with a sorry shake of the head. "It is nothing," she said. "Nobody loves it. Nobody sees it. Who cares about the looks of a castaway like me?" Her journey back was rather a meander than a march. It had no sprightliness, no purpose, only a tendency. Along the tedious length of Benville Lane she began to grow tired, and she leant upon gates and paused by milestones. She did not enter any house till, at the seventh or eighth mile, she descended the steep long hill below which lay the village or townlet of Evershead, where, in the morning, she had breakfasted with such contrasting expectations. The cottage by the church, in which she again sat down, was almost the first at the end of the village, and while the women fetched her some milk from the pantry, Tess, looking down the street, perceived that the place seemed quite deserted. "The people are gone to the afternoon service, I suppose," she said. "No, my dear," said the old woman, "'tis too soon for that. The bells ain't struck out yet. They be all gone to hear the preaching in yonder barn. A ranter preaches there between the services, an excellent, fiery Christian man, they say. But, Lord, I don't go to hear him. What comes in the regular way over the pulpit is hot enough for I." Tess soon went onward into the village, her footsteps echoing against the houses as though it were a place of the dead. Nearing the central part, her echoes were intruded on by other sounds, and seeing the barn not far off the road, she guessed these to be the utterances of the preacher. His voice became so distinct in the still clear air that she could soon catch his sentences, though she was on the closed side of the barn. The sermon, as might be expected, was of the extremest antinomian type, on justification by faith, as expounded in the theology of St. Paul. This fixed idea of the rhapsodist was delivered with animated enthusiasm, in a manner entirely declamatory, for he had plainly no skill as a dialectician. Although Tess had not heard the beginning of the address, she learnt what the text had been from its constant iteration. Tess was all the more interested, as she stood listening behind, in finding that the preacher's doctrine was a vehement form of the view of Angel's Father, and her interest intensified when the speaker began to detail his own spiritual experiences of how he had come by those views. He had, he said, been the greatest of sinners. He had scoffed, he had wantonly associated with the reckless and the lewd, but a day of awakening had come, and, in a human sense, it had been brought about mainly by the influence of a certain clergyman whom he had first grossly insulted, but whose parting words had sunk into his heart and had remained there till by the grace of heaven they had worked this change in him and made him what they saw him. O foolish Galatians, who hath bewitched you that ye should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Jesus Christ hath been evidently set forth, crucified among you? But more startling to Tess than the doctrine had been the voice, which, impossible as it seemed, was precisely that of Alec d'Urberville. Her face fixed in painful suspense, she came round to the front of the barn and passed before it. The low winter sun beamed directly upon the great double-doored entrance on this side, one of the doors being open, so that the rays stretched far in over the threshing floor to the preacher and his audience, all snugly sheltered from the northern breeze. The listeners were entirely villagers, among them being the man whom she had seen carrying the red paint pot on a former memorable occasion. But her attention was given to the central figure, who stood upon some sacks of corn, facing the people in the door. The 3 o'clock sun shone full upon him, and the strange, enervating conviction that her seducer confronted her, which had been gaining ground in Tess ever since she had heard his words distinctly, was at last established as a fact indeed. End of phase the fifth.